Let's talk about the enemies of writers. The writer and the page, the writer and the idea, the writer and the need to write. Most people assume that a writer's worst enemy is the blank page, its awful void, its daunting truancy. But there are greater adversaries. There is Jack, the dull boy who works and does not play. He relies on repetition, writing the same story over and over. And now in our age of computers, not even the distraction of a typo to interrupt derivative redundancy. Now, Jack is not public enemy number one, just bored, waiting for inspiration to strike, in which case he might very well be good and dead. And if death is a happy ending, it can also serve up a tedious end to the story waiting to be written. But even Notre Dame gargoyles can be bored, frozen in stone, waiting for Quasimodo, watching the Seine, while Paris enjoys wine, women, and song. The magnificent streets dreaming below. And if the enemies of fiction are plot, character, setting, and theme, then what's left? A corporate focus group intent on deliverables, marketing selfies, or finding a way to make two characters fall into hate with each other without explosive chemistry? No. Writing's enemies include excuses, plenty of reasons for that blank page, that space devoid of content. A dog's bum, a wagging tail, a set of sad eyes. Man's best friend, Voltaire claimed, but perhaps not. Mere vindication for unfinished words. Imagine a chapter of blank pages, the keyboard enemy, demanding that our fingers move to produce beauty. What to do with this tyrant, this accusatory appliance, this mute tool? Mere alphabet refusing to serve as our helpmate. Smash it. And what's this story? Women, the natural enemies of books? The booking of enemies. When women collect books, they mean trouble. As one sage put it, all the great women book collectors were immoral. Let that be a lesson in enemies. Now, male authors used to describe women as the enemies of books, jealous and incapable of understanding bibliomania. So women had no choice but to engage in bibliofabrications of their own, writing under enemy pens, George Eliot and George Sand, to name just two. But think hostility. She may look benign, but don't mess with this one. Nellie McClung, an Alberta adversary, formidable foe, could skewer men with her pen, told it was not nice for little girls to show their legs, so she showed some words instead. Well, we can blame it on the femme fatale, the dangerous woman under the lamppost, face almost but not quite visible in the flare of the match lighting her cigarette. Mysterious archetype for writers yearning for some excuse to point a finger at la belle dame without mercy. It's easier to make the opposition beer and cigarettes and junk food. The choir of all-nighters folded into adversary dawn with its benign threat of daybreak, the enemy of never enough time, and the night whiled away with procrastination. It's a venerable art, the cocktail of drinking and writing, retro as the fierce old Remington crouched and waiting for pummeling fingers. A challenger, this one, straight out of film noir, where a character makes pronouncements like, friend may be a word devoid of meaning, but enemy, never. Just retrench to the realm of the neo-noir, a saloon at Sweetgrass. How's this for composing a screed that will never make it to the 21st century? Two men writing letters home, their enemies the same as ours, time, and cold, and boredom, and distance. It's hard to imagine, but at the turn of the last century in Alberta, there was a shortage of paper. Here's an argument for two sides of the same story. Crossed letters, one written over the other at right angles so it could still be deciphered. Saving paper and postage. The deadliest enemy is the books already written. No need for more. The villainous bully of history turning spine on hope. Here's a challenge. Last year, the total number of books in print hit 28 million in English. Why bother writing? That's an enemy. The competition is so fierce, the book we write will more likely end up on a table in the great used book sale in hell than shining from a stage at the Gillers. The rival of hope is realism. The enemy of optimism is fatalism. Publishing has enabled superabundance. Well, there's an agonist, a competitor, the writer who wants to be a protagonist in this story, having defeated the blank page, ennui, distraction, and procrastination, against the antagonist, doubting and cruel, full of intimidation. Not to mention, of course, the audience and its doubtful literacy, demanding that writers pitch in and become as proudly ungrammatical as billboards. Pitch in. Any old word will do, and if its possessive is used incorrectly, well, no one will care about its performance. But what do a few jammed keys matter? A good enemy, a worthy opponent, sharpens words and their creation. Stephen King said, "Only enemies speak the truth. Friends and lovers lie endlessly, caught in the web of duty." All we can do is cherish an antagonist worthy of that deathmatch we call writing.